So, I'm from the Northwest, well, at least as far as this particular dimension is concerned, which means that I am familiar with a little town, some may consider it a suburb, known as Stilfontein. But if you've never heard of that place, even if you're from the Northwest, then don't worry about it. We are going to answer all of the questions that are bubbling up in your brain right now. And we're going to do it through the mechanism of a specific story about Stilfontein, which I think has many lessons that it can provide to South Africa at large. A YouTube channel under the name Lucien van der Walt released a miniature documentary, more like they shared it actually, on the 5th of April 2022, which was titled Liquidation, a Stilfontein story. This is the story I'm going to focus on regarding Stilfontein for the purposes of this particular video. The story of the liquidation of a gold mine, which used to be the lifeblood of that community, and in particular focusing on all of the fallout that resulted from that mine's sudden collapse. Let's go back to the mid-2000s. When was Easter weekend again? Not that long ago, right? Anyway, let's go back to Easter weekend 2005. What had happened back then in this specific slice of time?
Ek was devastated. Ekskuus vir die woord, maar dis die maklikste woord ek kan kry. Devastated. Ek was geskok. Ek was gekrenk tot binne my siel in. Geen DRD baas het vir ons kom het die vermoëlikheid gehad om vir ons te kom sê oor die die myne is ge
You can hear Mr. Van Donder say that none of the bosses at Durban Roodepoort Deep had any decency to confront them to their face and tell them as their workers that the mine had been liquidated. Many of the miners in fact found out about this from the security guards at the site. The security guards, by the way, who were telling them to go back to the hostels, telling them at 3 in the morning at the gates to go back to the hostels. They did not receive any formal notice for their termination. There was no correspondence, there was no paperwork, there was no communication. And yet these miners were now trespassing criminals for seeking to do the same thing that they were doing just the day before at the same place where they were doing it just the day before. And they were given this designation by security guards who purportedly were protecting them and who were presiding over workplace safety, again, just some hours before, which actually goes to show some of the real purpose of certain forms of security as protection of private property over human resources. Yeah, human resources in the most literal sense. That is how this mine perceived these miners. Well, at least while they were still working for them. After that, they were just trespassing riffraff. So the way that this was able to happen at all is that the mine workers were dealing with a company called Durban Roodepoort Deep, or DRD for short. And this is the company that they understood to be their employer. Now, when they got to the gates and the security guards turned these workers away, the workers then contacted the National Union of Mine Workers to ask what was going on.
I got a call, it was 3:30 in the morning, telling me that you are here as your members of the National Union of Mine Workers, standing next to the gate, and all the gates are locked. And the security guards are sending us back to the hostels. Do you know anything about this?
And the union had no idea, because as it turns out, DRD was only a subsidiary company whose holding company was called Biffelsfontein Pty Limited.
Die verbasing was groot met die liquidasie toe ons uitvind die houer maatskappy wat eintlik geliquideer is Buffelsfontein Pty Limited. Terwyl DRD het het die twee mynbedryf as DRD Noordwes bedrywighede. So dit was 'n verbasing om te hoor van hierdie dopmaatskappy Buffelfontein Pty Limited.
And it's this company that was liquidating the mine. But because it's a holding company, which means that it doesn't actually provide any of the goods or services, it just primarily owns shares. This allowed it to liquidate the mine and not tell any of the workers about it, because none of these workers were its direct employees. The holding company just holds shares, which means that they are beholden only to themselves. The workers were only the employees of the subsidiary company. But that subsidiary company is controlled by Buffelfontein Pty Limited, who again owned the majority shares in the company. So this is just a short explanation and example of how these holding companies get to control subsidiary companies, but without having to deal with any of the responsibilities to the workers of those subsidiary companies, which they control whenever situations like these occur. Because as I mentioned earlier, the National Union of Mine Workers was just as clueless about what was going on, since they themselves were dealing with the subsidiary of DRD as the employer. Buffelfontein Pty Limited surprised everyone here, and not in a good way. This kind of surprise was more in line with the bedeviled spontaneity of gender reveal parties. Only the reveal here was that you were laid off just 3 days before payday. Congratulations to the newlyweds. Green means the gender is unemployment. As you can probably imagine, the effects that followed were not pretty.
DRD. Daai mense het te veel hartseer in hierdie dorp gebring. Wel, ek het mense hierse van 60 en 61 jaar. Hulle het gesê, is die eerste keer in hulle lewe wat hulle moet vir kos vra. Daai mense kry swaar. Jy weet, hier is jong mense wat nou getroud is, 2-3 jaar. Party is nog nie 'n jaar, hulle sit met skuld. Hulle inkomste was skraal geweest. Ek weet van kinders wat R1500 huis toe gevat het 'n maand. Hoe kan hy nog met daai bietjie geld wat hy gekry het vir 5 maande sonder werk uithou? Daar is geen manier hoe daai mense en daai kinders kan voortgaan nie.
Can go to Kuma now is a disaster. Because you can talk about those who were working for TLD before. And not forgetting about people who were used to be supported by those people working for TLD. It's very, 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 very tense situation. Everybody now is staying there, having nothing. Some of them you will see moving up and down, searching what they can eat.
Kuma, for instance, the place that Mr. Naki mentions here, is said to be teeming with gangs nowadays. Even Jouberton is having trouble with gang activity nowadays. But more on that later. Right now, I just want to focus on the specific troubles that fell upon Stilfontein.
The problem is, ek het geweet, ons het nie kos nie, en ons het nie aankoop nie, of ons kinders te sorg nie, en die probleem is dit, ja, ons het al van ons goed ook in die huis verkoop om te kan lewe.
And many of these were young people who, when they were employed, used to earn a meager salary of around 1,500 rand a month, which would have been around $256 at the time. Our currency was a little stronger back then. Nowadays, 1,500 rand is something like $100 a month. So, once they had exhausted all of these more immediate options, it was then, and only then, that they turned to their government. Which, you know, they have every right to, of course. But I'm just saying this and pointing this out specifically to dispel the stubborn stereotype that poor people, the very first chance or opportunity they get, turn to the government for supposed handouts. No, okay, that's not how it works. The government, generally speaking, tends to be within the proximity of their last resort, because they are quite aware, perhaps even more so than any of the people that are making unqualified assumptions about them, that their government tends to fail them time and time again.
I'm not happy with government response. Firstly, our government, I love my government, but I have to criticize where I am. Our government have that law to the companies that say the company must liquidate themselves when you're in trouble. But the government didn't prepare when the company is liquidating themselves, that how should I help the people? Or what will I do as a government to the people? That's the first point that government that is making people to suffer in South Africa. And then, secondly, our government is very, very supportive to other countries when they are suffering. Like, for instance, Zimbabwe and the tsunami in Asia. And then if you can just determine the money that's spent there. And then now, last week, we hear that our government will borrow Zimbabwe $6.5 billion. Although we've got a disaster here at DRD.
This is actually a very common complaint about the government. We've seen it come up even recently, which would be 17 years after this whole documentary. We saw it when South Africa announced that it would be donating 50 million rands to Cuba. And in the grand scheme of things, that may not seem like much when you think about the budget of countries. But it certainly could have and would have meant a lot for local food groups, for instance. Giving money to Cuba and the like while having ignored the workers who you left without protections against the liquidation of mines, and who you allowed to join the armies of the unemployed under your watch, that right there is the art of performative communism and supposed socialist ideological solidarity with the working class, literally at the expense of the working class. Style way over substance. I'm sure that at that time, Stilfontein would have very much liked the ruling party, the African National Congress, to truly be as communist as some have threatened that it is. Instead, the real ANC made allowances for these companies to participate in these rapacious sorts of liquidation practices. Those practices of nested companies that can misdirect or even fool unions too, allowing those companies to be rid of their corporate responsibilities. By actually legally having no corporate responsibilities to their workers in instances such as these. And then that same government failed to support workers when they became casualties of said allowances. Again, it's only playing up the aesthetic or the image of concern for workers when it comes to the ANC and their partnership with the South African Communist Party or all their donations to Cuba. On top of that, this sort of attitude tends to help foster attitudes of antagonism against foreigners, and perhaps even full-blown xenophobia. Whenever certain resentments are aroused by at least the suggestion that governments care more about ideological posturing with political allies over and above the immediate economic priority of their own constituency. And the immediate local responsibilities of those who are supposed to be that government's beneficiaries. They're citizens. And these resentments, by the way, can undermine the whole solidarity with political allies if the citizens start to become more xenophobic or suspicious or biased against foreigners or anybody else outside of their immediate physical borders who they might feel is being prioritized over them through the sordid mechanisms of modern globalization. And then tomorrow that same government will be distancing itself from those people as the scornful charge of xenophobia is laid upon them, in part justified and in part laid upon them by that same government. Utterly ignoring any part that it, the government, had to play in cooking up some of these sentiments with its ignorance and stunning economic ineptitudes in the first place. This was a collusion in cruel failure between the government, here represented by the ruling party of the African National Congress, and the private sector, here represented by DRD and Stilfontein Pty Limited, both working together at the cost of workers and the communities for which those workers provided.
Ons Suid-Afrikaanse regering het ons afgeskiet. Ons het hoeveel aansoeke gedoen na hulle. Ons het vir hulle vertoë gestuur. Ons het met hulle ministers gepraat. En dit het absoluut niks afgewerk.
Yeah, we're very, very disappointed because we see our government moving up and down, going out of the country, trying to intervene on what is happening in other countries. But when it happened here in South Africa, affecting maybe more than 5,000 people, as it happened here, we don't see him coming to intervene on the situation that is affecting his people. I think on our side as NWM, which is National Union of Mine Workers, we're in a belief and understanding that everything has been happened due to the mismanagement of the DLT, which is Durban Road Apportive.
Hulle topbestuur het met alles weggeloop en die mense hier in Stilfontein met hartseer gelos. As 'n man, soos Mark Wesley Woods, 'n salaris van R38,000 'n dag kry, 1.2 miljoen rand 'n maand. En dan sê hy, hy weet nie van enige tragiese gebeure in Stilfontein nie. Wat 'n tipe mens is hy? En deur daai sulke dinge het hulle hierdie Stilfontein tot op hul knie gedring.
You see, I don't know what can I say to Mark Wellswood, because when I think about killer. Whatever they are doing as DLT shareholders, DLT management, you must think that they have employed people. Those people are not animals, they are human beings.
I don't think I will ever even talk to him. I don't have words for him because he has made a disaster in this area.
Ek wens net, Mark Wesley Wood, moet net 3 ure Stilfontein toe kom. Ek wil hom graag dit vir die dames gee. Wat van hom gaan word, weet ek nie. Maar die vrouens gaan hom, sekerlik, ophang of met iets anders te doen. Maar dit wil ek nie graag sê die regte woorde nie, ne. Maar hy sal nie weer 'n man wees nie.
Gogo Max Wexley Wood ndingathi nje is a killer. He used us like a condom. Because usebenza and then after that they throw us away. And then into endifuna umxela yona u Max Wexley Wood ukuthi akafanelekanga ukuthi abe khona be South Africa.
Titles like killer may seem like exaggerations, but one need only take a quick glance at what these surrounding areas have become in subsequent years to get a sobering sense of what these people are talking about, of what they were seeing coming down upon them when they were using words like killer.
Abandoned gold mines in the Northwest have become a breeding ground for organized criminal syndicates. Police in the Stilfontein mining area say rampant theft and vandalism have become a threat to national security.
Stilfontein, a once vibrant gold mining town, has become an empty shell. This is as many of these mines are winding down operations or have been liquidated. While some have abandoned the area, many have remained, resorting to criminal means to earn a living.
Initially, you will know that with the, you know, closing of the mines around here, it started as a social problem of people who are unemployed, who started, you know, going back to the mines that are closed to salvage for whatever they could lay their hands on. And then initially, it were cases of thefts. Were reported, but those cases then started, you know, to become even more extreme.
What started as common theft has now become an organized criminal syndicate, which is armed and highly skilled. Some steal metals such as copper and iron, Others strip the local infrastructure for anything they can sell. And they brave the risk of going underground to illegally mine gold. Among them are local community members who have equipped themselves with shovels, spades, hacksaws and hammers to reap what they can. However, police says this places a heavy burden on the community.
Critical infrastructure like your substations gets affected, and once they go and vandalize a substation, it affects not only the mining operations around here, critical infrastructure, your hospitals, your educational institution like Vuselela around here, you know, your residential areas all gets affected.
The area is also home to migrant mine workers who have been left stranded since the closure of these mines. They too say they are victimized by these criminals. Mining companies say they spend close to R1 million on security each month. But still, their vast property is difficult to police. Both the police and private security have become targets of illegal miners.
As we explore youth issues countrywide, in Jouberton in Klerksdorp, youth are battling to survive in this gang-ridden area.
Now, many are recruited by hardened gang leaders, forcing them to drop out of school. With over 20 gangs operating in the area, police are largely unable to contain its growth.
Jouberton Township, notorious for gangsterism. The numbers world dominates here, as the youth are recruited to commit crimes to fund these syndicates. Many, like 28-year-old Lebogang Mokgethi, joined in their early teens.
The reason to join the gangster is because of I lost my parents, and then the care that I was getting from my parents, I didn't get it anymore, so I was alone. So that's why I end up being a gangster. Because I thought maybe something, I will get something from crime. But wow, absolutely, I couldn't get anything from crime.
Assaults and robberies are commonplace.
There's a lot of gangsterism here, especially in my neighborhood. We are even scared to walk the streets because they take our phones.
Meanwhile, for local police, crimes committed by gangs are more complex than what meets the eye, as most of these activities go to fund criminal syndicates operating both behind bars and on the outside.
My worst fear is if we do not deal with the scourge as soon as possible, we might actually escalate to what is in Western Cape. And once that arrives, with the type of the townships that we have, we are definitely going to find a challenge.
We don't talk about this enough as a potential drawback to hosting mines in some of these cities. We talk about the potential good that it will do a community, which is good and which is true. But we generally don't go out of our way to impress upon any community that may be considering hosting a mine to alert them of these potential drawbacks. The fact that they will drain the workers of those communities. They will poison the air with anthropogenic mountains of thin dusts that get into your eyes, into your hair, into your lungs, and even weaken the health of children. The very people for whom the workers are trying to build a future when they take these jobs, but then unknowingly participate in an industry that costs these children their lungs with environmental impact and damage, thus costing them that very future they're trying to build for them, and in the name of that future. We don't talk enough about the holes that these mines dig and leave in people's lives and communities when they inevitably abandon those communities. We don't talk enough about an exit strategy for everyone involved. We don't talk enough about the degradation and dilapidation that is left behind in the wake of unimaginable profits. We don't talk enough about the holes in people's cultures, the vandalism of cultures and of heritage and of history that begins with the desecration of ancestral graves in order to make way for these mines in the first place.
Allegedly, later selling it to the mining company.
This land belongs to the people who were staying here. We were staying here, we were born here. Our fathers and brothers, they worked that thing that was called tree money, which means they were buying that land from the white people.
Today, the elders say they are unable to visit their ancestral graves to conduct sacred cultural rituals.
We can't even visit our ancestors' graves and do what we have to do.
It hurts. We've been crying for many years. We watched helplessly as our land was taken from us and sold, and the other part of it being given to the community of Kabunso.
But Anglo-American Platinum says there is no evidence to support the community's claims.
We commit significant time and resources to ensure we comply with the laws and regulations governing all grave-related matters in South Africa. Unfortunately, cultural heritage experts have been unable to find records or any other evidence that the graves that were allegedly removed by the company existed.
Anglo-American Platinum has suggested a legal recourse for the community.
We have repeatedly urged the complainants to escalate the matter to the CRR Rights Commission, and we've offered our full support in this regard. It is therefore regrettable that they've refused to explore this crucial avenue that is available to them in terms of the Constitution.
But the community of Sporong is adamant that they should be compensated for the land they were forcefully removed from.
The same cultural vandalism that ends with gangsters and their bastardization of sacred traditions and initiation schools, in order that they, the gangsters, should breed an army of economic scavengers that then descend upon these abandoned mines and upon the carcasses of surrounding communities, like vultures with their metallic handheld beaks.
Police statistics confirm township gangs are an increasing national problem. Over the past 5 years, they have plagued the community of Sebokeng in the Vaal Triangle. Unlicensed initiation schools in the area act as breeding grounds for these gangs, feeding them with new members. Despite attempts of local authorities to counter gangsterism, gang violence continues unabated.
Another major issue was that small businesses were affected by this. Because if the community at large doesn't have the money to spend on everyday items or miscellaneous necessities, which are the specialty of your small local corner store or stores, then those businesses really suffer.
It's unfortunately a chain reaction. It's not just Stilfontein employees that have been affected. The smaller community has been affected, the smaller businesses have been affected, the whole town, as you see for yourself, is dead. I mean, it's totally devastated.
Everybody used to come to the shop and buy their bread and milk and whatever, and now at this stage, you know, everything dropped. Normally I get about, say, 40, 45 loaves of bread a day. Now, today, I only got 6. It's a big drop. You know, all the businesses are suffering because the people haven't got money. And you're too scared to give them an account because you don't know when they're going to pay. You've got no idea when is everything is going to get together.
The corollary, of course, being that when communities have money, they spend it on supporting local businesses.
Tweede of die derde maand af het hulle nie meer goed gehad om te pand of te verkoop nie. En ons het maar daaraan gedink om die mense so goed maar so lank as moontlik vas te hou. Maar ag baie mense het opgetrek en so hulle het maar opgegee op die goed, verstaan. Jou eerste items wat gewoonlik inkom wat hulle nou pand is gewoonlik jou hi-fi of jou naaimasjien of jou kinders se fietsse, verstaan, goed wat nie elke dag gebruik word nie. So as die mense se yskaste inkom en die TV's en sulke goed, dan moet jy weer daar is nou nie geld.
That city of Matlosana / Klerksdorp is quite divided these days. There is a growing EFF presence and people moving from the townships to Stilfontein doing essentially land grabs.
Disgruntled residents putting off shelter on the land belonging to the local municipality. They say there are no developments in their area. And with the closing of the mines, the area is experiencing a high growth in population. The community says they have engaged with local councillors to see how their area can be improved.
We have taken a decision to engage with our leaders, whom are councillors, and we invited them in several meetings so that they can join us and have deliberations so that we see where we can assist each other into making sure that our township, the transition of 25 years, it can't be correct that after 25 years so many people are still struggling places to stay.
With some community members say, the area where they currently stay is overcrowded, leaving them with no choice but to invade this land.
We also need to grow and have our own responsibilities. So that's why I decided that I must come here and look for a stand for myself and my kids.
We are living four people or six people under one roof. So now that is the reason why we decided to come to this land.
The municipality says the area that residents have occupied is not suitable for residential developments. An alternative land have already been earmarked for a new housing project. Zebulon Maine, SABC News, Stilfontein.
You also have a growing VF Plus presence whose influence might be coming down from Potchefstroom. And I noticed while looking for some stuff up that there is this Facebook group in Matosana/Klaagstorp for the Saitlanders. I don't think it's very active anymore. I don't know, but it just goes to show some of the divisions that have been brewing in the communities surrounding this area, of which Stilfontein is but one. Oh, and if you don't know who or what the Saitlanders are, good for you, okay? Don't look them up. Don't find out. If I ever even expound upon that, they might be a subject for a completely different video. Or maybe I might touch upon them when I talk about farm murders at a later stage. I hope you are understanding, though, how dire things became in the surrounding areas as a result of this company's callous actions. Protected by a government that looks after its own pockets for the sake of politicians instead of, you know, their constituency at large. Or, at the very least, the workers and poor on behalf of whom this ruling party claims to be fighting the good fight every election season. However, that's not all there is to the story of little old Stilfontein. Because for a moment there, in the deepest, most depressing state of affairs following the liquidation of that mine, there was hope.
Was it a crisis of honor? Want deur dat die mense nou geen werk het, gaan daar geen salarisse wees nie. En daar het ons besluit dat ons 'n voedselskema gaan opbring.
That's right. They began a feeding scheme, which was originally only supposed to be for the members of Solidariteit, a trade union. And we will talk about solidarity in another video. I think this one might be long enough. Anyway, it was supposed to be for those members. But then they extended the program to the community at large in an effort to feed the thousands of families that were further economically displaced by this whole liquidation fiasco.
With all due respect, how can you only look after your own members if you've got so many other people standing outside there that don't have any other source of income, hungry mouths to feed? How can you turn them away and just feed your own? This is true unionism, to look after each and everybody in the community and not turn anybody away and say, sorry, but we cannot help.
Ek sê vir jou, ek was 'n paar huisgesinne gewees. En ek wil nie vir jou vertel hoe lyk dit binnekant nie. Dit is pateties. Hoe ver 'n man was as jy nie seep het nie. Hoe jy tanden was as jy nie tandpasta het nie. Jy is elke dag dit gewoond. As 'n vrou moet sekere behoeftes nodig het, en sy kan nie kry wat gaan sy gebruik. Dus hoekom hierdie kosprojek sorg net nie vir kos in jou maag nie, maar jy sorg vir ander behoeftes wat jy dagliks nodig het. En daardeur, nee, probeer ons die mense nog steeds hulle lofwaardigheid behou.
I mean, what do I even say? That's just amazing. What can I add to that? They got it right. They know what it's about. The dignity and true unionism. Freaking yes.
Hulle gaan die fiets van my maak, maar dan gaan hulle machine
doen. Maar jy gaan op geschiedenis
en dan ben je brengen over die avond getrokken. Ha! 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 Police maak dat de bank wel gaan doen.
Ervaar ons eerstehands dat kinders met wie dit voorheen verskriklik goed gegaan het. Kinders wat baie goed versorg was en wat genoeg kos gehad het om te eet en genoeg van alles gehad het om te eet, het dit onmiddellik nie meer nie. En die ouers se hartseer, omdat hulle nie meer kan sorg soos wat hulle gesorg het nie.
Een vrouw het geloop in die straat en sy het by die huis gekom en die een kind het buitenkant gestaan en speel in die koue. En sy het vir haar gevra, wat is die, hoekom gaan jy nie in die huis in? En toe sê sy, nee, vanavond is dit my boetie se beurt om kos te kry.
Even myself, my child, we was nearly fired at the school day in class. But they are just waiting until I pay all the fees.
Mense wat baie meer kinders het as ons. Hulle het nou al so al hulle meubels verkoop in hulle huis. Hulle slaap op die grond, daar is net nie kos vir hulle nie. Hulle is afhanklik van die kos wat ons by solidariteit kry.
But then, 3 months after the liquidation, there was only 2,000 rand left in the food fund. Miners were desperate to return to work. So, care to take a guess? As things got worse, what might have happened to this unionism? Care to take a guess, if you're brave enough, what happened to these racial tensions? I'll let this white guy tell you.
To come to a place like Stilfontein and to see what I've just seen, the rows and rows of people standing for food parcels and packages, and to see that black and white, they're in the same boat. You know, times have changed.
Trade Union Solidarity has asked the government to declare a state of emergency in the Stilfontein area as thousands of miners and their families are going hungry.
That's right, you old cynical, pessimistic billy goats. I misdirected you. No, the worse things got, the closer these people worked together along racial lines. Because they were in the same boat, after all, which was sinking.
Binnen 'n kwessie van 20 minute toe is daar 3000 mense. Jy kan nie 3000 mense binnen 'n straat al klap vashou in die grond. En ek het geweet dis onwettig. En ek het geweet ons gaan moeilikheid kry op die pad. Maar ons het 'n klein hekkie gesien en ek het die swartes mos al mee gevat en het my soos 'n swart golf deurgestoot en ons dat my kon kry tussen in die pad.
Sending a strong message to our government that please, there is the Department of Mineral and Energy. They must come down. They must come down to us and listen to our problems. Because now we are sitting here with a problem. We are fighting for food here in Stilfontein, black and white. We are waking up 3 o'clock in the morning to come and collect a packet of macaron and 2 oranges, 1 potato, 1 onion. It's not a joke, it's serious.
We just want our jobs back so that we can get proper money, that we can sleep warmly, had a piece of meat, a piece of bread, and a glass of milk, and a cup of coffee. We can't do it, because we got no money.
In die strate en toe het ons omgedraai en toe gaan ons na die nasionale pad toe om te maak ons die pad. Dit was absoluut fenomenaal. Wit en swart het saamgestaan. Vrouens met prams en kindertjies en babietjies, selfs ou mense wat nie kon loop het saamgeloop.
This sort of attitude unheard of in the year of our Lord 2022. At least not on places like Twitter. Although I do hear that a white South African who has denounced things like apartheid and understands all the nuances involved there is the one who owns Twitter now and is at the helm. So, good news maybe, huh?
I think that much has helped us a lot because the government, it was then that the government that noticed what was going on in this area and they started giving us some forms to fill in so that we can get some grant, but we have not yet received. We are still waiting for that grant from the government.
Dit was nodig. Ons het vir die mense gesê, ons moet toi. Nee. Omdat die liquidators nie hulle kan bring nie. Hulle verspeel met tyd. En ons mense wat hier in Stilfontein sit, het nie tyd, het nie geld om langer aan te gaan met speletjies nie.
Ek glo dit het die mense gewys in watter krisisse is die mense werklik in Stilfontein. Want as hulle dit nie gedoen het nie, dan was 'n dag daarna nog niks gedoen nie. Baie keer moet mense ding doen wat eintlik onwettig is om mense se oë op te maak dat groter mense wat met hierdie dinge te doen het kan sien kyk wat gaan werklik hier aan.
Grateful for them because without these companies and the people, organizations, the unions, everybody, I don't think we could have survived.
Kijk, eerste plek is willen voor die bikers van zondag. Daar was plus minus 150 bikers in Stilfontein. Ek het gestop en ek het gehuil. Want my hart het opgegaan voor die bikers.
We've got people coming in as far as Appington delivering milk. We've got people giving fresh vegetables, we've got farmers giving meat. All we can say is without them, we wouldn't have come so far.
Okay, daar is een, dit is van Egeland Hoërskool. Hulle het ons 2 weke terug van Alberton na Durban toe gehardloop.
Ja, nee, ons sal bietjie stop.
We tend to splinter off into our little corners whenever things get bad. Pointing our weapons at everything and everyone else. We only come together when things are going great, when we are winning, to put it in simplistic terms. That's when we embrace each other. Most of us, anyway. But we don't tend to unite in our struggle. We don't own our problems as our problems. No, it's you guys need to deal with the drugs, and you guys need to deal with the racism, and you guys need to deal with the crime in your areas. You guys need to do this and that and fix your problems. They're not our problems. Which is why we are seeing a rise in political operatives who represent the will of black people, or represent the will of colored people and colored interests, or the will of white people and their rights, or perhaps even a further split along English and Afrikaans people, something like that. More people like this are showing up, and more will continue to show up, because again, in South Africa, our problems are not ours as a community. There is something for us to learn from that Stilfontein of 2005. And that is dignity and true unionism. 2005 is much closer to the Zuma years than to 1994. So this wasn't just the hazy rainbow optimism of the late 90s that had these people banding together. They earned their collaboration through mutual shared material interests. They were in the same, they were in the same boat. 2005 is a different universe in many ways. I mean, in 2005, for all you know, I was one of those kids. Things have changed. Again.
Werkloosheid is nie 'n maklike oplossing vir hom, maar wat Stilfontein se unieke omstandighede vir my is, is dat mense het 'n vaste inkomste gehad op een maand en die volgende maand het hulle nie geld nie. En dit is absoluut vir my skrik aan jaant. Ons boerderyomstandighede is baie moeilik, dit moet jy weet. Maar alle boere wat moontlik iets kan afstaan, maak nie saak wat nie. Is bring dit vir die mense.
We have found ourselves back at a place where we have to decide what sort of country we want to be. And yeah, I get it, that's kind of an exhausting thought, right? Why can't we just catch a break for one generation? One whole generation, okay? Please, just one? But look, in the effort to reclaim ourselves to ourselves, and with the potential opportunity that the coming decade can present to us, the opportunity to restate our vows to democracy and to recommit ourselves to freedom. In doing all of that, we don't have to reinvent the wheel here. There are some things we have discovered in the past, specifically 2005 here, be careful if you go back any further than that. Things that we have already practiced and that we can revisit with fresh enthusiasm and a rejuvenated demand and direct action. All of it for actual change in the public and private sectors to the benefit of the majority of ordinary South Africans like you and me. People nowadays tend to think that democracy is failed and that democracy is the problem that we're facing in South Africa today, when really, no. As you can see, all these people in this video, they were fighting for more democratization. They were fighting to have more of a say because they did not have enough of a say. So the answer isn't for us to have less democracy, it's for us to have more democracy. April 27, 1994, was a step in the right direction. It was not the whole mission. So we need to be doing more. More democratization of South Africa's institutions and structures. All of that said, this is not the final word in the matter, of course, and I'm sure you can figure some of this stuff out for yourself. Happy belated Freedom Day, South Africa. Shup shup.